therapy, sometimes I've used the exercise of drawing a line on a sheet of paper. One end is your birth and one end is your death. And where are you now? Be shocking for people, but it helps them take a look that there is a schedule. And as we look back on our life, what do we feel about it? Most people have some regrets. Many people will be filled with regrets. There's so much about their life that they regret having done or not having done. Then you can get some therapeutic leverage by beginning to raise the question, well, suppose we were to meet a year from now. What could you do during this year so you'd live a regret-free life? The idea of knowing oneself or curiosity about oneself is kind of a function of the kind of brain we have. I think it's inbuilt into us and we search all the time. The more that we know ourselves, the better lives we can live. And when we get into trouble, very often it's the expression of parts of ourselves that we don't know very well. I've been doing psychotherapy for over 50 years now. One way I think of myself is I'm a guide on this voyage of self-exploration. And I'm a guide because I've been there before. You know, guides usually, people have taken this trip many times, and I have. There are unconscious forces in us. And that was what Freud introduced, that we should attempt to understand ourselves, to get our unconscious illuminated, to see what's there. He postulated that if we're not understanding ourselves well, then a lot of our baser animal instincts can be in play a lot, leading to a lot of violence and unhappy sexual expression and pursuits. Once we can understand, that tends to take the fuel out of the neurotic symptoms and gradually they dissipate. One is never fully explored oneself. There's always more. We begin to look at the whole issues of how it comes to pass that he thinks there's no further area to explore. So that's an area to explore.
Your life is a witness to the power of stories. What are some of the interesting twists or surprises that have occurred in the storyline of your own life?
My own life?
Your own life. Your real life.
Well, the first twist is, the first twist that comes to my mind is a day like today. You know, I get a lot of applause and a lot of honor. But there's a part of me for which this is very unreal. My parents were uneducated entirely. So I always feel I don't have any foundation behind me. It's a little destabilizing. And no matter how much success I have or how popular my books are, there's always a little uneasiness. Is this really me? Have I really done this? So that's the strongest answer I can give to your question.
They came from Poland. They wanted us to be Americans. At the same time, they really wanted us to be Jews and religious. And the name of my father's shtetl, it was Seltz. In Washington, they had a Seltzer Society, and all the people came from Seltzer together, and that was my parents' clique. They only knew people from there. The family lived very much in a ghetto. My mother, once she came, I did one of my first presentations at a big American psychiatric conference, and then I was taking questions from the audience, and my mother got so nervous she just couldn't stay in the room because she was afraid I wouldn't know the answer to the questions. I'm sure she didn't read the books. She couldn't understand them, and her English is too bad. And much later in life, she was pretty nearly blind, but she held the books and smelled the books. Not an easy person. No one got along with her very well. She disapproved of almost anything I did, but it was never any idea of what I should be doing. She never had a nice word to say about anyone. There were a couple of years, really, where I hardly ever talked to her, maybe years 15 to 17. We lived in the same house, but we hardly exchanged any words together. It was a pretty bad relationship. I think I just had to protect myself that way. Could I have done anything to make her life happier? Well, I probably should have been talking to her those 2 years. My father had a heart attack when I was a teenager. My mother, she was hysterical at that point, and my father looked like he was in terrible shape, and she was yelling at me that I had killed him. And then the Dr. Manchester came, and he related very well to me. I remember his tousling my hair, put his hand on my head. I remember his letting me listen to the stethoscope and his reassuring us, and that kind of tremendous relief I had from his presence, that was something that I really thought was so powerful I wanted to be able to pass it on to other people. So if you're asking me for a time when I first decided to be a doctor, that would be it. I can't get my mother out of my mind, in a sense, and there's almost a yearning to be with her. Grief is more difficult with people with whom you have unfinished business. When the death comes, the conflict is frozen in time. Thank you. the great majority of patients that come to see me, they fall into despair because they're not able to form an intimate, a nurturing, lengthy relationship with other people. If we don't fully understand ourselves, I think that we also may not fully understand others or appreciate others.
After all, in the middle of a film that's going to look rather academic or philosophical, why not have them discover that you're a real flesh and blood person with nothing to hide?
I'm glad you're having such a good time.
I'm having a good time.
Usually you won't get in here, all of a sudden you're hopping in.
Well, why not?
I think you're an exhibitionist.
Well, maybe. It's possible. If I don't have an audience, what was the point?
Right.
I met Irv when I was 14. We liked some of the same authors, Dostoevsky, Dickens, and Steinbeck.
I was absolutely certain of it. This was the right woman for me. It's not that I had a lot of girlfriends to choose from, and she was the best, so I will say that, because I was pretty shy about that time and awkward. And never thought I was very attractive.
It's funny, it was not his looks that I fell in love with, but his personality. He was interesting. He was always interesting. Some of the girls thought he was a bit of a nerd, although we wouldn't have used that word at that time.
You know, I wasn't cool in that way, and I couldn't dance.
And I think the other strong point that he had was that he liked me. And that was very clear from the beginning, and he seemed very safe.
I mean, we went steady, if you can use that term, all the way through high school. And I was going steady. There were times maybe she wasn't going steady, but I was. And then she went to college at Wellesley.
We met when we were very, very young. Regardless of what you think, I should now regret it very much if during the past 6 years I had not known and enjoyed other males. This period of light flirtation has certainly added to my life as a woman and has given me the assurance that I could handle myself quite adequately with most gentlemen. Unfortunately, you couldn't see that my enjoyment of others did not in any way lessen my feelings for you. The fact of the matter is that I can enjoy and benefit from my relationships with others while you do not, or at least you have never given yourself a chance to find out.
I studied all the time. College and medical school were horrors for me. The medical schools would only take 5% of their class for Jews. So that meant I really had to have a very good record to get in.
I think that there are some people who have a stream of anxiety inside of them, that in Irv's case, it probably expressed itself in being impatient or in feeling somehow that he had to prove himself in life. There wasn't a great deal of ease in him.
You know, I was living with a lot of anxiety from the outsider wanting to be an insider. I was very pressed to get out of the world I was in, get out of the ghetto in a way. When I started medical school, I was in a tremendous hurry to get through, get married, nail down this nice-looking woman that I had met that I liked very much and wanted to make sure she didn't get away. I was terribly anxious. I had problems sleeping. And it was all these things that I began to work on in my therapy. The therapists are in therapy their entire lives. So learning and changing and growing is kind of part of our lifelong education. So knowing oneself, you know, is very important. Socrates spent a lot of time teaching that, and I agree very much with him. Patient now has come in because of a lot of obsessions that he has. He's got to keep checking numbers and checking figures and having magical thoughts in his mind. But underneath there is a lot of rage. So gradually this patient is getting into some of his angry thoughts about his parents. It's very, very hard for him to express these. He's full of fear when he talks about it. There's a lot of shame because he ought to have a great deal of respect and love for his parents. And yet, in fact, he doesn't. There's all kinds of reasons why you can't face some of these things that are inside of you. People are ashamed. People imagine what the other will think. If they were to disclose something, and they'd be rejected or scorned or humiliated in some way. But in therapy, people begin to learn that the kinds of things they worry about are the sort of things that everybody worries about. They're not so different. It's like welcome to the human race sort of feeling.
I think it's a therapy dream, but it's a little bit tangled, and I think it's my mother's apartment, but I'm still not sufficiently comfortable that I'm willing to be undressed in her bed with her soon to be there or coming home soon. I'm still guarded. There's still
sometimes we're talking about their growing up and their parents. It's important for people to begin to understand their parents and understand what their parents were going through, too. The parents were exposed to certain kinds of parents, and it's passed on, you know, from generation to generation. And what we hope to do is to try and break the cycle.
But I'm willing to plunge my hands in.
I didn't want to repeat the cycle of a passive father and an overly aggressive mother by choosing someone who was not going to be aggressive. Marilyn is someone who has her own mind, but there's no ever any attempts to overpower me. My father started a tiny little grocery store in Washington, D.C. They worked unbelievably hard. They worked early in the morning to the store closed at 10 at night. And I was always very annoyed with him that he had to do what my mother said. It was a pretty bad section of town I grew up in. Outdoors, it was not so safe out there. Not necessarily from the blacks in the neighborhood, but also from the redneck whites. The library was quite safe. The biographies were alphabetized, A to Z, and I just started reading all the biographies from A on. Filled me with sadness, not having any kind of guidance. There's a sense of taking a lot of pride in the fact that you've been your own creator, you've been your own father, you've been your own mentor. That can give you a lot of satisfaction. On the other hand, there's this longing, and maybe a kind of early life longing for a mentor or a parent who would have guided you and taken you along all this way. When I was a teenager, it was very strong with me that the best thing a person could do in their life was to write a really good novel. When I went to medical school, it was with the idea, not psychiatry, that's as close as I can get to Tolstoy and Dostoevsky. They were great psychologists. I thought I could use what they could teach us about that in looking for patients, and I could begin to use my experience, perhaps in my own writing. I could see that psychiatry could be a place that I could write. And almost everything I've written since then, and all the books of stories or novels I've written, have been books that have illuminated some aspect of how psychotherapy works. I started my psychiatric residency at Johns Hopkins. At that point, it was de rigueur, really, for people to have a personal analysis. I started my training right away with a Freudian analyst. For 3 years, about 700 hours, I lay on her couch and pre-associated. And she was basically, as analysts were, a blank screen, heavily unengaged, made only interpretations. And frankly, it was of very little use for me. I kept feeling all the time, this is a really bad model for psychotherapy. And 700 hours is a costly way to learn that, but I think I learned how not to be with patients.
But I remember just the dream of leaning brushing
your hair. Was hair pulled forward. You were brushing your hair, you wanted to get your mother out of your hair. That's what
I feel like you need to be much more engaged, and you need to form an authentic, genuine relationship with the patient. The therapist is both participant, I'm participating in this relation, but observer. You know, I think that the model that the therapist set for a patient, the
the intimacy, the connection, that gets put into the patient's mind, and he uses that as a reference point, an inner reference point for how he relates to other intimate relationships in his life.
I'm a surgeon. I look at facts. I work with facts to help other people. Now, I'm not a surgeon anymore. I'll never practice again. The stroke has ruined me. I even have to learn how to walk again. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm confused. I don't even know what my body's telling me. Whether the pain that I feel is something to worry about or not. I'm uncertain about what's going to happen next.
George, I know this hasn't been easy for you, but I feel you've shared a whole lot. I feel very moved by what you've said. I feel a lot closer to you. I feel like I kind of know exactly what you're going through.
I guess so, but it's...
You really did that today.
It sure is hard.
I got interested early on in my training in group therapy. And one of my teachers was a man named Jerome Frank, who had been a pioneer in group therapy. And I watched him lead a group through a one-way mirror. They were very new at that point. We couldn't have been much bigger than about 6 inches. And all of us had our heads crammed up trying to see through that mirror. And then we'd meet with him afterwards. And then later, if he were out of town or something, he asked me to lead the group for him. So that was my first introduction to group therapy. And later, when I was appointed to the faculty of psychiatry at Stanford University, I started right away to teach in the field of group psychotherapy. All the students had to lead a group for a year and had to watch my group through a one-way mirror. A movement sweeping this country. They were saying, you know, psychotherapy is too good to be used just for the sick. I was very heavily involved in that movement. We did a big study at Stanford. We had 150 students, some of them going to groups. And we studied what happened to them. So I had a lot of material to do a lot of research on groups worked. I was one of the first who did groups with people suffering from terminal cancer. These were hard groups to lead. It certainly confronted me with my own anxiety. Nobody experiences this kind of work without really feeling shaken up. That's written about this group that I first formed, the very first one, where people had different kinds of illnesses. 62 years old, embittered, gravely ill with leukemia, Evelyn was wheeled into the group with a blood transfusion in process. She was candid about her illness. She knew she was dying. "I can accept that," she said. "It no longer matters. But what does matter is my daughter. She's poisoning my final days." After her daughter, caring for Evelyn's cat, had fed it the wrong food, they had not spoken to one another. After hearing her out, Sal spoke to her simply and passionately.
Listen to what I have to say, Evelyn. I'm dying too. What does it matter what your cat eats? What does it matter who gives in first? You know, you don't have much time left. Let's stop pretending. Your daughter's love is the most important thing in the world to you. Don't die. Please don't die without telling her that. It'll poison her life. She'll never recover. And she'll pass on that poison to her daughter. Break the cycle. Break the cycle, Evelyn. The appeal worked. It was our group's first triumph. And then one patient said during the group, what a pity it was I had to wait till now, till my body was riddled with cancer, to learn how to live. So a corollary of that is, well, is there a way we can help people learn that earlier? And that became a major motif of me and my work. People may not be aware of what they do that distances them from other people. That's why feedback is so useful in therapy and in the group as well.
And so I figured that anything else that might help it work out. I have a 2-year-old, and so I thought it'd be a good idea. And my wife really pushed me, insisted that I do this.
So it sounds like you're here because your wife insisted that you're here, or you're here for the marriage, but that you're not here for you yourself.
You know, I come home and I'm hoping for a little peace and quiet, and as soon as I get in the door, the wife's at me with this and she's at me with that. I just feel like I don't have any time of my own, you know, and it's just like that at the office, and she's irrational.
If you're in a group of people and the rules are you give people honest feedback, number one, and number two, and we keep on communicating. We stay in this group and keep on tuning. Because often if you give that kind of person that feedback outside, that's the end of the friendship or the end of the relationship. It breaks off. But here the group is, we keep on communicating. And then we have a leader in the group who makes sure that feedback is delivered in a way that the person can accept and integrate, not in a hostile, rejecting way.
Let's just try a thought experiment for a couple of minutes. You see Dan here, you live with him in a sense for an hour and a half once a week. Just imagine living with Dan, each of you, being married to Dan, relating to him 24 hours a day. What kind of experience would that be like? You know, get yourself into that. What feelings would get evoked by that experience?
To me, you know, because remember Dan, you said once that your wife accused you of being absent? For me, that's a perfect word for you, absent. You're never really here with me. I mean, look at your chair. Even your chair is a couple of inches out of the circle.
I really think that I'd be getting angrier and angrier, too. I'd put a lot of demands on you. Probably even get shrill or irrational, just like your wife. I really think so.
You know, I've been aware over the last few minutes we've been sort of escalating the force of our comments to you. I think I've been doing it, Joan's been doing it. I think all the people here have been doing it. And I think it's an important phenomenon that's been occurring. It's almost as though that to kind of get through and help you speak with your real voice, we've got to keep on getting more and more angry, or to use Betty's words, more and more shrill. It's almost a replica, I wonder, of what might happen at home.
Thank you.
I went through a period in which I was very interested in Irv's field. I was writing, you know, a psychoanalytic interpretation of James Joyce's Ulysses, you know. And then I made a switch when I moved from teaching literature into women's studies. I don't say that psychotherapy is inadvisable for other people when you have a good therapist. But for me, maybe I had had so much already in my private life that that's not what I needed.
As sensitive to the world around you as you are to your body. That's so nice.
Okay, is that working? Yeah.
Not very
working.
Well.
Well, no, here. Oh, no. What about this thing on the top, Irv?
Try it. Original dish. It's never been cooked like this before.
Never with wine.
And it gets a little dry. I'll add a little bit more of that mushroom juice for it, but I think it's going to be good. Okay, it is a little dry on top. We both try to have a lot of respect for the other's desires and wishes. Love is a way of being, a giving to, not a falling for, a mode of relating at large, not an act limited to a single person. Let me add to that another paragraph, the first paragraph of that story. Now, that's in the prologue. The first paragraph to the first story is a short paragraph that I think I always feel is one of the best ones I've ever written. And I had a publisher who loved that and memorized it and would say it to all the booksellers. So the story starts off, "I do not like to work with patients who are in love. Perhaps it's because of envy. I too crave enchantment. Perhaps it's because love and psychotherapy are fundamentally incompatible. The good therapist fights darkness and seeks illumination, while romantic love is sustained by mystery and crumbles upon inspection. I hate to be love's executioner." One of the great paradoxes of life is that self-awareness breeds anxiety. Fusion eradicates anxiety in a radical fashion by eliminating self-awareness. The person who's fallen in love and enters a blissful state of merger is not self-reflective. Because the questioning, lonely I can dissolve in the we. Thus one sheds anxiety but loses oneself.
We get married in 1954. You change, the other person changes. Sometimes Irv would be two steps ahead of me, and then I'd catch up and I'd be two steps ahead of him. It's a dance. Oh, I'm sure that there were moments in the course of the marriage where I would have walked out. I mean, there are always those moments. But in the end, the tie to Irv and the tie to the children and the tie to the family was always proved stronger. So I never moved out.
There were times that I might fall in love or be prey to that, and that was a great feeling to have, but it was always very, very temporary. And I always had this attachment to Marilyn that was so rock solid for me. And I had a lot of children early on in my life that always occupied my attention.
I think the important thing is to be able to go through it together and to realize that your primary commitment is to the other person. That's something that one has to remind oneself all the time, you know, over and over again, that to steal some words from Simone de Beauvoir and Jean-Paul Sartre, your essential relationship is with the other party. I mean, I do think that when other things have come up, other temptations, I'm not even talking about sexual temptations, but something that would pull you away from the marriage. We have always been able to discuss that and to say that the other person comes first. I think sometimes that was a little hard for our children, you know, because they always felt that the bond, the primary bond, which was between Irv and me.
Is not just a passion spark between two people. There's infinite difference between falling in love and standing in love. The idea is that you stand in love, not fall in love. You try to live in such a way as that you're always bringing something more to life in the other.
I'd like you to look at this passage that I've written about Abelard and Héloïse. Héloïse had held on to her, quote, love beyond all bounds for Abelard long after he had withdrawn from her. And so they come down historically as the prototype of the male who is driven primarily by lust and the woman whose sense of attachment is much longer.
Well, no. Wait a minute. Yeah, all women, as though men don't go through this too. I mean, I've seen men by the dozens who are pining for this old lover that they've had. This happens to men too. This is not an absolute gender issue.
Well, I'm thinking in particular, as I write here, of the book by neuropsychiatrist Lou Anne Brizendine. She says that a man has 2.5 times as much brain space devoted to sexual pursuit as a woman, while the female brain's empathy system is considerably more active than the male's.
It's almost saying that men can't have real love for women or want to be with them. I want to send them away. I wouldn't think of sending you away.
That's true. My 4 children have very strong bonds with each other, and they've been very supportive of each other when they've gone through divorces. All of them have been through divorces. Of course, that raises the question. Here you have parents who are married for so long, and yet somehow that kind of lifelong marriage didn't work for our children. It's the sort of thing Irv and I thought a lot about and don't have any easy answers for.
You know, they were very young when they had us, and they were very ambitious. I felt that maybe we'd been shortchanged a little bit by them. So my children were a little bit more important. And I think a lot of my generation was that way. You know, we didn't put the marriage first. We put our careers, and then you felt a little guilty about your children. So then you put your children, and then the marriage was a little bit further down.
It makes me sad for my daughters that they don't get to have a father to lean on.
I would like to learn from my grandparents' relationship, certainly more than I would like to learn from my parents' relationship. But, I mean, at the end of the day, you just have to figure it out for yourself.
Wife Wendy and I were the last remaining couple, and so there was this sort of sense of, oh, it was really contingent upon us to keep it together. And it was strange also in the fact that we had a relationship that I thought was going very well, and at a certain point we started to have some problems, and we went to therapy, and we really, I thought, worked it out pretty well. And then one day I woke up and Wendy said, I can't do this anymore. Really quite out of the blue to me. And maybe I wasn't paying enough attention, but it was really quite a shock. And it was Thanksgiving, and we were supposed to head down to the parents' house and spend the next 3 days en famille. And that was tremendously difficult. And within 2 days, she had said, you know what, I can't do this, and left. And I felt very ashamed. Not only did I feel heartbroken and sort of in shock, I felt very ashamed at revealing that this had happened to my parents.
You always have this little figure on your shoulder. It's your parents, your consciousness, and you judge, you know, what am I doing? What are my parents thinking about this? If I'm dating or marrying this person, is this somebody I can bring home to mother? Is this somebody that they're going to like? And for me, I realized about 4 or 5 years ago that the little figure on my shoulder had changed. It's actually no longer my father. It's my son.
Okay, can we finally give you some dessert?
Yes. Would you like some coffee?
Yes.
How many coffees?
To the rest of the world, he's a very serious psychologist. But then to me, he's this very funny guy that's more carefree when he's around the family. Just trying to have fun and disconnects himself, and it's kind of interesting talking to people who know about him, and they're like all super tense, oh my god, he wrote my favorite book and stuff. But then for me, it's just, yeah, he's my grandfather, he's fun, he's happy, he tells jokes, you know? And it's just such a contrast of these two kind of personalities that he has.
As I've gotten older, I think I see more similarities between us. So, I mean, he's always my father, but as I see him as an adult and not as a child, I realize he's introspective, you know, connects with lots of people, but he certainly prefers more intimate, one-on-one, deeper conversations. I chose his profession, and I share certain interests
with him?
I think in many ways we have some similarities. For some reason, kind of set myself apart from people. I've tried to not to do that as much. Try to be more empathic, understanding towards others. I think it's a lifelong task.
The overwhelming majority of patients suffer from stress that to different degrees is part of every person's experience. In fact, only the universality of human suffering can account for the common observation that patienthood is ubiquitous. André Malraux, to cite one such observation, once asked a parish priest, has been taking confessions for 50 years, what he had learned about mankind. The priest replied, "First of all, people are much more unhappy than one thinks. And then, the fundamental fact is there is no such thing as a grown-up person. Often, it's only external circumstances that result in one person and not another being labeled a patient." We have to take cognizance of the fact that all of us, at some point or other, are threatened by the factors that are intrinsic to our existence. We all have to face the inevitability of death. We all have to face the dilemmas of freedom. We all have to face this fundamental question of what's the meaning of life. Every culture has done this since the world began. We all have to face questions about isolation. We all want to merge and pair, to submerge this lonely I into a we. You know, I think these are universal. Different cultures handle it different ways. Different individuals handle it each way. But the therapist has to deal with those very issues for himself. I found a great many philosophers who had written about these existential concerns. So I read many, many years, and I ended up writing this textbook on existential psychotherapy. I've always tried to write saying every good therapist needs to know something about these issues because they're going to be relevant for many of your patients. I could ask you just to meditate upon your own being. And just screen out everything else, your cell phones and your daily schedule. If you get down to the deepest layers, what will you begin to think about? live for? What's the point of life? Is a powerful force in the life of every single one of us, and whether we know it or not, it's having an amazing influence on how we live. And the same thing is true for the existential concern of isolation. With the existential concerns around isolation, and therefore use relationships almost as a shield. It's not a caring for the other, it's using others as a shield against loneliness. Kant was the philosopher who brought this very much to my mind. There's a unique world that each of us inhabit because no one has had the exact same experiences as you have had. Close, we try to relate to another person. There's something, some space that can never be bridged. Luscious feelings and smells and tastes that I had when I was young, and I think they're out there, but they're really only in my mind at all. And when I cease to exist, that world goes also. There's a certain kind of shock there, a certain kind of sadness. Self-awareness is a terrible treasure that we have. But nonetheless, I've never believed that awareness leads to madness or denial to sanity. My psychotherapeutic approach is thus epitomized by Thomas Hardy's comment, "If a way to the better there be, it exacts a full look at the worst." years old now. In the 70s, all these things go wrong with your body, and you can't do the things you want to do, and it's a time for, and your memory is beginning to lapse. It's a time for the onset of some terminal despair, but it's just been the opposite with me. I feel freer and not anxious about things, and I feel very creative and very excited about my work. So I just want to say to the younger people, there may be even better days ahead.
I want to thank Jeff for inviting me and allowing me to talk about anything I wanted to talk about. I'm overwhelmed with the size of this audience. It's a huge audience. I know you're not all here to hear me, but some of you are. And there is a logarithm, really, that I'm very much aware of, that as I grow older, the audiences get larger and larger. That's very affirming, very affirming. But if I put on my existential spectacles, there's a dark side of that, too. The dark side screeching in effect. What's all the rush about anyway? If I get very loose, I think of something you've seen, that there's a new movie out called Capote, for Truman Capote, an American writer. There's an anecdote that was told about Gore Vidal, when Gore Vidal was given the news that Truman Capote died. His response was, "Ah, good career move." Anyway, that's being very loose.
After writing the book on existential therapy, I felt that somehow you could get at the truth of that much more with powerful narrative. I really sort of turned over another chapter in my life and then thought, I'm going to be a much better teacher as a storyteller. I started the novel when Nietzsche wept. I have two characters that are Nietzsche and Joseph Breuer. Each of them had a love obsession with a woman. Breuer, in that book, he was out of the relationship, but he couldn't get her out of his mind. He was passing through a certain life stage. He presented himself as always feeling that he was a man of infinite promise. But the fact is, he was reaching midlife, and he wasn't going to be on an eternal ascent from that point on. In a sense, that love obsession was shielding himself from that. I have seen a great many patients for whom that kind of obsession persists and persists and persists. Try and think, what's the meaning of the obsession? It's very important to understand what's the meaning of the symptom. In the next session, Alvin spoke more of his grief over his parents' death. He recalled the shock when he realized that he had become an orphan. The worst thing was my sleep. How did you resolve it? How long did it take? Eventually, he hesitated for a long time. His speech became very measured. Eventually, I developed the habit of masturbating in bed every night. That was the only thing that worked. And ever since then, I've masturbated every single night. That became my sleeping pill. Alvin flushed and seemed so uncomfortable that I offered him some breathing room by turning back to process. I can see how uncomfortable it is for you to speak of this. Alvin nodded. Let's see. It's not easy. I thought you'd think I was bizarre, an infant sucking his thumb at night, a creep, defiling his family. Yes, a creep. That fits best. And you'd be repelled. No wonder you're not going out with women. You're jerking off every night. None of that, Alvin, didn't enter my mind.
My thoughts went to the connection between sleep and death. Did you know in Greek mythology, Thanatos and Hypnos, death and sleep are twin brothers? Alvin listened intently. No, I didn't know that. Interesting. And I continued, your comment about being an orphan is so important. I've heard many others lost their parents say that, and I had the very same thought myself when my mother died. When parents die, we always feel vulnerable because we're dealing not only with loss, but also with confronting our own death. One aspect of becoming an orphan is that there is now no parent between us and the grave. So we began to talk about that, because in a sense, the death anxiety for some people is countered by a sexual arousal. It's almost our great vital response to the threat of death. You know, sexuality is the center of being alive. I don't think we can really eradicate the fear of death. As therapists, what I can work with is ways of overcoming the terror of death. And one of those ways is, what is there to fear if there'll be no consciousness? Death terror seems to defy our scientific views on things, or anything that we can reason through. It seems so obvious to me that consciousness is a function of mind and the activity of our brains. And when the brain ceases to function, our mind ceases to function. It feels like a wonderful thing if we think of a heaven or an afterlife in which all our desires will be met in perpetuity. But to me, it's a fairy tale. Wishing doesn't make it so. You look back on your life, and what regrets do you have for the way that you've lived so far? If you have a feeling that you've done what you wanted to do in life, I think the idea of death comes much more easily for you. Schopenhauer had a comment that I always liked very much. He compared his various tyrannical drives, especially for him, a very powerful sexual drive. He compared it to the sun. But then he says, as these drives began to weaken and get less and less and less, and the sun got dimmer and dimmer and finally faded away, suddenly he could see the night stars and the night sky, and he saw all these wonders in the sky that he'd never really seen before, so because he was always diverted by the tyrannous compulsions they had. So that's another nice metaphor to think. Some of these other things begin to die away, and see all these wonders of life that you hadn't really noticed before.
So right now, I'm enjoying the night sky. Thank you.